waging information warfare against pushers of fake news. You're listening to Real News with David Knight.
Welcome back. I'm David Knight. In the next segment, we're going to play the final installment of the interview that I had with Charles Van Vick. At the bottom of the hour, we're going to be talking to Lord Monckton, and he's going to give us an update as to what's going on with Brexit, with Catalan, and also with the some amazing research that he's done that shows the fraud of the model, is, I guess, the best way to put it. It shows how the climate change models are fraudulent. What is real science? You know, we had Harrison Ford come out and say, you know, the problem that we have is that we've got people who are ruling this world who don't understand science. Well, I guess we should take a lecture from the guy who has been a pioneer in hyperspace travel. But I'm not really sure what his scientific credentials are. Lord Monckton is going to explain to us what the scientific process is. How do we do science? Maybe we should talk about that. And we are going to talk about that with him at the bottom of the hour. We're also going to talk about gun control and the fake news, how CNN covered this story and some other stories. It was an interesting back and forth between CNN and Kellyanne Conway. Of course, the guy who was at CNN was the individual who looks kind of like George Costanza from Seinfeld. Every time I look at him, I can't get past that. But he's not as nice even as George Costanza. And George Costanza wasn't really a nice guy in that show. But let's get back to the news. You know, as we're looking at the liberals calling for gun control, and as Mark Collins, a former pastor of the church, is down there ministering to people, and as he said, as he's listening to the mainstream media talk about gun control as they're covering this, we need to remember, as we approach the 100th, we've now hit the 100th anniversary of the coup in Russia, as Zero Hedge points out, remembering communism's bloody century. That was the title of an article that they had. And if you haven't familiarized yourself with the term democide, as Mark Collins was pointing out, that's death by government. The tens of millions of people who were killed by government, particularly communism, in the 20th century. And we need to understand that that always begins, whether it is the authoritarians of communism or whether it is the authoritarians of fascism. They always want to take your guns first. Gun control began in Nazi Germany, and they made it into an art in the communist countries. Of course, they also banned religion as well. So keep that in mind as the left is telling you that we have to surrender our freedoms, that we have to be spied upon, that we have to they have to confiscate our firearms. We're going to talk about gun control. We're going to talk about the fake media. Real quickly, this news blitz at the top of the hour, we have Congressman Matt Gaetz has introduced a resolution calling for the recusal of Special Prosecutor Mueller. He said evidence has emerged that the FBI withheld information from Congress and from the American people about Russian corruption of American uranium companies. A confidential U.S. witness working in the Russian nuclear industry revealed that Russia had deeply compromised an American uranium trucking firm through bribery and financial kickbacks. Although federal agents possessed this information in 2010, the Department of Justice continued investigating this matter for over 4 years. The FBI, led at the time by Robert Mueller, required the confidential witness to sign a non-disclosure agreement. When the witness attempted to contact Congress and federal courts about the bribery and corruption that he witnessed, he was threatened with legal action by the FBI. By silencing him, Obama's Justice Department and Mueller's FBI knowingly kept Congress in the dark about Russia's significant and illegal involvement with American uranium companies. These deeply troubling events took place when Mr. Mueller was director of the FBI. As such, his impartiality is hopelessly compromised. He must step down immediately. And I would add that calls about an investigation about corruption and obstruction of justice should begin in its place. It is absolutely amazing that the individuals in charge of this obstruction, in charge of this illegal transfer of material, should be the ones leading an investigation into every aspect of President Trump's life. And understand, as I pointed out before, the authorization for the Office of Special Prosecutor expired long ago, 18 years ago. There is, as Al Gore would say, no controlling legal authority, and there is nothing legal about this investigation. I'm David Knight. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm David Knight. We're going to talk in this segment about the push for gun control. But before we do, I want you to hear the last segment of my interview a couple of years ago with a man who was in a church that was attacked in South Africa. He was the only individual armed in that church. It was a very large auditorium there could seat 1,500 people. He was at the back far corner away from where the attackers came in. And there were four individuals with fully automatic weapons and grenades. They began by throwing grenades in and opening fire, just spraying the crowd. And he was able to stop this one man who only had a .38 special with five shots in it. But I want to play the segment where he was talking about how he had to think about whether he should protect innocent life as a Christian, whether he should use force. He subsequently came to the conclusion that he wrote a book called Shooting Back and talked about not only your right, but your duty to protect innocent life. Let's go back to this interview with Charles Van Vick. God's providence that you were able to stop this with just a .38 and five shots. But you were the man that God used. Tell us how you came to carry a .38 with you to church.
David, a long time before that, I was traveling with a friend near a little town called Wellington outside of Cape Town. We were going through to his parents' farm, and I was driving a small little pickup, very small little vehicle. And all of a sudden, there were tires burning in the streets of the car, and that was the African National Congress, which was Nelson Mandela's political party. They were burning tires in the road, and as my car came to a standstill, they started throwing rocks and bricks at our vehicle and rocking the vehicle with these bricks that were smashing the windows and denting the vehicle. So that was what happened then, and after that, I made the decision to purchase a firearm, and the next time my life was threatened, to use it to protect myself and my family. But it was a long walk for me. I'm telling a quick story in a few minutes, It was a long theological issue for me as a Christian, whether I could carry a firearm in civilian life and then use it to defend myself. I didn't.
Well, certainly looking back at this, I mean, in hindsight, we can see that you saved a lot of lives. I mean, with 58 people that were wounded and another 11 that were killed. And these guys said after they caught them that they'd been given instructions to throw petrol bombs, Molotov cocktails into the church. It would have been massive carnage if you hadn't fired back at them and they fled.
Many people said they were expecting them to actually walk up and down the aisles and just mow people down.
Yes.
And after the attack, I reached out to them with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and one of the unit commanders said to me, I knew all about the attack before it took place, and our greatest desire was that there wouldn't be a living soul afterwards.
Wow. And you stopped that by having a gun. As I said, we can see in retrospect, but talk to people who are pacifists, people who are Christian pacifists. Tell them about this journey that you took and how important it is, because we're looking at this right now. We're thinking about the political aspect of it. Every time we have a shooting in America, we have the president and those who want to take away our firearms. They will use this as an opportunity to try to do that. But I want you to talk to the people out there, maybe who are sitting on the sidelines, who are naively thinking that the government is going to protect them. Because how long did this whole thing take? It didn't take that long, did it?
No, David, it's probably a couple of seconds. You know, there was write-ups in the newspapers talking about it being minutes. It was all a couple of seconds. A grenade takes, 5 to 7 seconds to go off. And in that time, everything was finished and over and they were gone.
Yes.
So, and as I said, some people were expecting them to walk up and down the aisles. That never happened because one of them had been injured, shot at. And so they ran away.
And no matter how good the government is, the government would not have been able to help anyone there. And we've had honest sheriffs in America tell people in high crime cities like Detroit, look, we'll do what we can to stop these people and arrest them, but you need to get a firearm. You need to train yourself so that you're not a victim. And then we'll find the bad guys after you defend yourself, but we can't get there quickly enough. So talk to Christians and tell them about this theological journey that you went through, your perspective.
Sure. Well, we have a saying that a gun in the hand is better than a cop on the phone. and so I think that gives you a bit of insight into the way we feel about it here. But the scriptures are very clear. 1 Timothy 5 verse 8 does not provide for his relatives and especially for his immediate family. He has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. And provision isn't only for food. Provision is also for the security of your family. That's why people put locks on doors. That's why they have security gates and burglar bars and these sorts of things where we live in South Africa. It's because we need to protect our families. And if we don't do anything to protect them, then the scripture is saying that we're worse than an unbeliever. In other words, this is a primary responsibility that we have.
Yes. If Christians are not going to defend the innocent, that is worse than an unbeliever. To me, I look at it as if someone were to come into my home and they were to start to beat my child in front of me. And I just sat there and say, well, I can't strike them because I'm a Christian. No, I have to defend the innocent because I'm a Christian.
That's right. Exactly. And I wrote a book on this called Shooting Back. And the subtitle is The Right and Duty of Self-Defense. In other words, it's not just a right that you have. You have a duty before God to protect the innocent, and especially those whom he's entrusted to you. And so it's actually a disgrace for Christian men to say that they're not willing to protect the innocent. In fact, when it talks in the scriptures about how a man loves his wife, the idea is that you must love her like Christ loved the church. That means you need to be prepared to die for your wife, not just stand by and watch while she gets raped or murdered by somebody.
Yes.
That's just pure cowardice in the face of the enemy.
Yes, and certainly it's interesting because, you know, we typically think about. And that's what we saw yesterday as the individual who stopped the shooter got there as quickly as he could. He was delayed. He said he felt bad because his weapon was locked up in his gun case. He didn't have it loaded. It took time for that, but he still saved a lot of lives. He ran even before he put his shoes on, as Mark Collins, a former pastor there at that church, explained to us. Let's take a look at gun control and the calls for gun control. Remember, or maybe you didn't remember, back in August of this year, because it wasn't really reported in this country, that there was a shooting in Melbourne, Australia. Remember Australia, the place where they banned all firearms, where they collected them, where you've seen pictures of them crushing the guns publicly? Well, that didn't stop a drive-by shooting in Melbourne, Australia, this last August. The man that was shot died. They said it was a suspected drive-by shooting in Melbourne, Australia. As 12 bullets were found inside the house, the victim had been standing in front of the house, and at the time that this article was written, they were still trying to find the gunman. They said he's still on the run. You see, bad guys are going to be able to get guns, or they're going to be able to use cars to run down people, or they will pull out their butcher knives and slit your throat, grabbing whatever innocent young people or women they can find. That's what they're about. And that's why we need to have the tools to protect ourselves. And that's why I wanted to play that for you, because you need to understand that it is your duty to protect innocent life. But let's take a look at what some of the Hollywood stars are telling us, because they know what's best. Chelsea Handler is blaming Republicans immediately. The former Netflix talk show host, whose show was canceled, and now she's going to be a full-time political activist. So you're going to be hearing a lot from her. She said, innocent people go to church on Sunday to honor their God, and while doing so, get shot and killed. What country? America? Why Republicans? She said at other times, she said, obviously, the state of gun control in this country is totally unacceptable. And the gun lobby is so strong and so powerful that anytime a celebrity can bring attention to this cause, among other causes, you know, it's an easy thing for anyone to do. She said, nobody's trying to take away your guns. Actually, she is. And actually, they have absolutely no clue. I can bet you they're not going to talk much about the heroes who stopped this shooting. They're going to focus on every other aspect so they can take away your God-given liberties that are protected by the Constitution. They better get a constitutional amendment for that. And we better have a government that starts removing the infringements that they've already put on. Stay with us. We'll be right back. I'm David Knight.
I like to do things where I know I can at least take control of it myself personally. And this isn't a pitch for water filtration, but we go out and find the very best gravity-fed water filters where it takes out all the garbage but doesn't take out the good minerals. And then I put my drinking water through that. And if I'm lazy, I've got reverse osmosis, which really cleans the water but cuts out the minerals. So over time, is you know, probably not too good for you to only drink reverse osmosis. That's in all the studies. But the other big area is the shampoo and the sunscreens and the cosmetics and the body washes and the soap, which isn't really soap. So we had spent, and this is a plug, but it's really informational until the bottom of the hour, when Sheriff Arpaio joins us. We spent years saying we want to get an organic, high-quality line of toiletries and personal care products so that I can use them in my own home and know from the manufacturer it's really what they say. And, folks, we got Mark Gonsalves, the owner of Nature's Brands, one of the biggest organic brands in the country, one of the top sellers at Whole Foods. Everybody recognizes our labeling because he's so nice. He even let us use basically his labeling, but changed the name to Emmerich's Essentials. So whether you get it at Whole Foods under his name or from us, what's best about it is it's on the low end of cost, but better than a lot of the other so-called organic brands and is so respected. But I wanted to get him on because he's the expert. He's got a bunch of the brands there of what's in some of the other leading brands and some of the other supposed natural brands that really aren't organic. But Emmerich's Essentials is Nature's Brand.
We're under a chemical assault. It's unbelievable to me what we've allowed to take place. We've got 84,000 chemicals now in play, 13,000 of which are used in our cosmetics and personal care items. And we use these things every single day. Yet about 10% have ever been tested. So we always rely on the chemical company to be able to be considered innocent until we end up proving them guilty. Does that make any sense at all? So all these things that we put on our body, they're going into our bloodstream. It takes about 28 seconds to go into our bloodstream. So here's what we've got. We've got the FDA that says, hey, you know what? For external use only. Think about this, think about this. They say it's for external use only. They're not stupid at the FDA. They know it goes into your bloodstream.
What is the establishment gonna do when all this comes out? It's already come out about bisphenol A and atrazine, and then they're still putting it in stuff. What's gonna happen to them? Why are they doing it when I've looked it up? They've got chemicals that are even less expensive that they could be using that have less problems. It's like they go out of their way to do this.
I think that companies today, are they purposely trying to kill us? I don't know if I'm gonna go quite that far, but what I will say is they don't seem to care if they do. They don't seem to
exactly
care.
Just like Bayer with the hemophiliac factor VIII, they knew it was in there and they said, you know what, we'll lose money. Go ahead and ship these millions of dosages. They just didn't care.
Exactly. Hey, you know, Ford, that as a young person was Ford with the Pinto, right? Oh, yeah, well, yeah, we have 30 gas tanks that will blow up. Yeah, we'll get sued for millions and millions of dollars. But, hey, at the end of the day, that's a heck of a lot cheaper than having to replace all those gas tanks in a recall. I mean, golly, we got a business to protect. Again, when you place a person's well-being at the bottom rung of the ladder and you place purely profit at the top, that is something seriously wrong.
Well, we're really impressed. Mark, thank you so much. Naturesbrands.com. Folks can get their Emmerich's Essentials private labeled by you. God bless you. At InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, or 888-253-3139. Mark Gonzalez, thank you so much, sir.
You're listening to Real News with David Knight.
Welcome back. I'm David Knight on this Monday, November 6th, 2017. I want to take a look at some of the more calls for gun controls from liberals, but I also want to take a look at the fake news from CNN because we had some amazingly stupid things said yesterday. And of course, we've got Glenn Beck calling us stupid because we attacked Jake Tapper for saying that Allahu Akbar was a beautiful thing. Used at beautiful events, under beautiful circumstances. We understand exactly what Jake Tapper was saying. And I got banned by Jake Tapper yesterday. Isn't that amazing? I guess Twitter is going to be next. I was absolutely amazed to find out when I saw some news about Alec Baldwin and the Twitter spats that he got in with people. And I've never, I don't remember ever sending anything to Alec Baldwin. As far as I'm concerned, he's a non-entity, both politically and entertainment-wise. But when I went to look, I thought, well, how many people has he got even following him? Is this an issue? Why are we seeing so many stories about this? So I went to look at his Twitter handle to see how many people he had, and I was banned from Alec Baldwin. So I guess I'm getting around. I don't know. It's an honor. It's an honor to be banned by Jake Tapper and by Alec Baldwin because they're because of what they're doing. But we'll tell you a little bit more about that. Before we do, real quickly, and we've got Lord Monckton joining us in the next segment. We're going to talk about, we've been talking about the shooting in Texas, and we're going to finish up in this segment talking about that, and we're going to start talking about climate change, about Brexit, and about Catalonia, because those are very important issues that affect all of us as well. Before we get back to the news, I just want to remind you of some of the sales that we have at InfoWarsStore.com. This is what supports this operation and what keeps us independent and allows us to go toe-to-toe and expose the lies of Jake Tapper, the lies of Glenn Beck. And we've got a news conference coming up real quickly here. We're going to cut to in just a moment. I want to remind you that we have Biome Defense now back in stock. You can get that at 25% off. Some of the other popular items that we have reduced in price as a thank you to those of you who support our operation. Survival Shield X2, that's our nascent iodine. Also, BioTrue Selenium, that's our 100% non-GMO. It's made from organic mustard seed. Our BioTrue Selenium is 40% off. Winter Sun, our vitamin D supplement, 50% off. Silver Bullet, our colloidal silver, 50% off. And you can also get 10% off of Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink Mix. Just enter the code VITA10 at checkout. That's VITA10 at checkout to get 10% off of Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink Mix. We really do appreciate your support. All right, let's cut to that news conference that we've got going right now. I see that we've got that there. You guys ready with that?
He was residing in New Braunfels, Texas. The cause and manner of the death in this with the shooter will be determined by pathologists during the autopsy. However, investigators found evidence at the scene that indicates the subject may have died from a self-inflicted gunshot wound. We can tell you, as in with all active shooter situations, the number one goal of law enforcement is to neutralize the shooter. In this situation, we had two Good Samaritans that did that for law enforcement. This call went out as an active shooter call. Law enforcement was responding, but we know that a local resident that lives across the street from the church heard what was going on. He armed himself with an AR assault rifle and engaged the suspect. They engaged in gunfire here at the church. We know that the suspect was shot when he dropped his assault rifle, jumped in his Ford Expedition and fled the scene. This Good Samaritan, our Texas hero, flagged down another young man from Seguin, Texas, and jumped in his vehicle, and they pursued the suspect. We know during that pursuit, the suspect used his cell phone to notify his father that he had been shot and didn't think he was going to make it. Subsequently, he shot himself, and so as I said, the pathologist will determine the cause and manner of his death. We can confirm that the suspect did not have a license to carry. The suspect did have a non-commissioned, unarmed private security license, similar to a security guard at a concert type situation. There were no disqualifiers entered into the National Crime Information Center database that would preclude him from receiving a private security license. Private security background checks, including fingerprints and a criminal history checks with the Texas Crime Information Center and National Crime Information Center databases, were checked, and he was cleared. I can tell you there is video recording from inside the church that has been secured, and we have viewed the video. The crime scene investigation will go on for days. All the bodies have been removed from the church. Our victims will be autopsied at the Bexar County Medical Examiner's Office. As I said, our suspect was autopsied.
All right, let's come back and just recap what they're saying at this live press conference. They believe that he died from a self-inflicted wound, that he didn't just necessarily bleed out. He had been shot, and as Mark Collins had told us from there, and of course a former pastor of that church, said that the reports that the hero who stopped this used a shotgun were inaccurate, that he had an AR-15 as well. So he was able to shoot him in the side where he did not have body armor. At that point, he dropped his gun and he fled. I didn't hear the person giving the briefing say anything about a hostage, so not clear exactly what's going on with that. But they're now saying they have not determined exactly, but they believe that he may have died from a self-inflicted wound rather than bleeding out. But I think it was a matter of time anyway. And as they're saying, he was able to clear the background checks. The gun was purchased at Academy Sports, which is a large chain. I know that they do background checks. It's not anything with them that was skirted. It was the fact that they did not have him listed in a no-purchase database, even though he had assaulted both his wife and his child. He was 1 year in prison in the military, was dishonorably discharged, and yet did not have down as a felony listing, somehow was able to escape that. Let's take a look at the insanity from the left as celebrities are calling for gun control. After we remember that it was a citizen with a gun that stopped more death and would have, he wishes that he could have been there sooner. And of course, so do the police. You can't get everywhere where there is an issue. This is a very small town, and it still took them more than 5 or 6 minutes to get to the church. At that time, they were long gone, and the people who were who had stopped him and who were pursuing him were on the phone, 911, with the police telling them where the individual was, and it still took another 5 to 7 minutes for the police to get to the site where the car had stopped and pulled over or crashed on the side of the road. But we have this kind of stuff coming from Stephen King, the horror novelist. He says, how many more have to die before we enact sane gun control laws? Yeah, well, you know, when we look at the left, we look at people like Stephen King, and we, as Mark Collins pointed out, what we're seeing here is not the fact that we need to get rid of guns, but we have a deep moral problem in this country. And people like Stephen King, people like Sarah Silverman, people like Josh Gad, Chelsea Handler, they are contributing to this situation, just as they have contributed to the moral depravity of America, these Hollywood pedophiles. They bear a great deal of blame for the society that we have, the moral sickness that is at the heart of this. But we still have good people, and those people have a right to protect themselves, to protect others. I'm David Knight. We'll be right back with Lord Monckton. Stay with us. Welcome back. I'm David Knight. We've been talking about the horrific shooting just south of here in Sutherland Springs, Texas. We're going to change our topic now and have Lord Christopher Monckton join us from the UK. And of course, if you're a listener to InfoWars, you've heard Lord Monckton many times. He's a businessman, newspaper editor, an inventor of a great puzzle that still has a lot of people scratching their head, unable to solve it. A classical architect, trained orator, and a high priest of climate skepticism. That's what we're going to talk to him about in this interview, as well as what's going on with Brexit. We want to get an update on that. He was a special advisor to Margaret Thatcher as she served as prime minister from 1982 to 1986. And, of course, you can find many of his papers published at What's Up With That. That's W-A-T-T-S, whatsupwiththat.com. But I want to talk to him about some about a paper that he's going to be giving in about 2 days, I believe, at the Karl Popper Memorial Lecture. I think he has a real breakthrough here, breaking down the flaws of the climate models, and I want him to explain that to us. But, you know, Lord Monckton, we had a news item today about Harrison Ford, and he says the greatest threat that we have today is people who don't believe in science. And although Harrison Ford has made remarkable contributions to our world in terms of hyperspace travel, I'm not really sure that he's qualified to speak about science like you are. I don't know what his degree is in, and I don't think he understands the scientific method, because the scientific method isn't something that is based around belief or around faith. We keep hearing these people call us deniers as if it's their religion, and to a degree, I think it truly is their religion, isn't it?
Well, David, it's a pleasure to be with you. And first of all, every sympathy to the families of the latest victim of a shooting. And it does seem to me that the answer lies in your constitution, which says that you can hold guns in the context of being part of a trained militia for the protection of the population. What yeah. that means is you can't just go in and buy a gun. You ought to be trained first. That's what the Constitution says. And I think a lot of these mass shootings would stop if that constitutional provision were properly enacted. And from our experience in trying to ban guns here in the United Kingdom after we had a mass shooting at a school, the result was that crime related to the use of handguns went up by 40% in the following year and hasn't gone back down again since. So mm-hmm. banning handguns is not the answer. Training people to use them properly and safely is the answer, and that's what your constitution calls for. So implement it. And so to climate change. Now, yes, we are about to announce a major discovery, the discovery which will finally demonstrate that those of us who have been called climate deniers, with that deliberate and nasty flavor of association with people who deny that 6 million Jews were killed under the Nazis by Adolf Hitler. That's why they use that word of us. Yes. Harrison Ford is no doubt better than I am at driving the Millennium Falcon, but I don't think that he's as good as I am at doing climatological physics. In fact, I don't think he'd know where to start, to be honest. I and my team, for the last 2 years, have been working very hard on something which some of us, including my colleague Michael Limburg, who is my host in Germany for the talk that I'm about to give in Dusseldorf in a couple of days' time, as you say, we have been looking, he's been looking for 15 years for this particular error, which we have finally run to earth. And the error is a fascinating one, and I'm going to describe it to you in 30 seconds, and you'll find you'll be able to understand it just fine, though Harrison Ford might find it rather difficult. So here we go.
Well, his mind is closed. It's a problem, is that his mind is closed. But give us your 30-second breakdown. Yes.
That's right. So very simple. Here is what we've discovered. We've discovered that officially they say there will be 1 Celsius of global warming per doubled CO2 directly from the extra CO2. Then they say there'll be another 2.5 Celsius on top of that from what they call temperature feedbacks, more water vapor in the atmosphere, less ice to reflect the sun back, the sun's rays back into space, etc. They call these feedbacks, and they say that multiplies by about 2.5, the original 1 Celsius of warming from doubling CO2. Now, what we've discovered is that those feedbacks will largely not happen because they have been calculating them incorrectly. And there will only be about 0.25 Celsius of additional warming from feedback. So you're looking at about 1.3 Celsius for doubled CO2 concentration and not the 3.3 that is their central case at the moment, and certainly not the 10 or 12 Celsius that Professor Schellnhuber of the Potsdam Communist Climate Institute has been hawking around as the likely effect of our influence on the climate. So what we've discovered is that these feedbacks have been incorrectly calculated by climate scientists who have borrowed their method of analyzing feedbacks from control theory, which is a different branch of science and a much more disciplined one than climatology, and they've borrowed the mathematics from control theory without understanding it. And they've all copied each other's errors for 120 years until now.
Wow, wow, that's amazing. So it breaks down the infamous hockey stick that Michael Mann has put out there for us that Al Gore made a movie about.
Yes, that was always nonsense, the hockey stick, yeah. Which is supposedly a record of temperature change on the surface of the Earth over the last 1,000 years it goes back. And the idea is that it declined gently until about 100 years ago, and then mankind began influencing it, and it suddenly shot up. The truth is that it was warmer in the Middle Ages, during the warm period when the great cathedrals of Europe were built, than it's been at any time since, including today. It then got a lot colder in what's called the Little Ice Age about 300 years ago. You're too young to remember all this, so I'm just reviewing it for you. And then it has got warmer again, but not as warm as the medieval warm period. And so what Michael Mann came along, he used some very, very dodgy techniques to try to wipe out the medieval warm period and pretend that today's warming was unprecedented in at least the last 1300 years. That was the kind of slogan that came out. But one scientist who looked at this commented wryly that Michael Mann ought not to be at Penn State University. He ought to be in the state pen, because there was so much wrong with the way that he did it. Michael Mann, I should point out, disagrees with the notion that he should be in the state pen, and he sues anybody who says that. So I'm not saying that. I'm merely recording the fact that somebody else has said that and is being sued. But
well, he is a bit litigious, and he does not want to see his basic research data or information made public. And I was with a group that tried to challenge that, the attorney general in the state of Virginia. And of course, you were talking about how your research created a great deal of consternation at the University of East Anglia. And people may remember that was where the ClimateGate emails eventually came out of. We had two different releases of emails saying, hey, this is not working. We need to hide the decline and so forth. And they were also corresponding to Michael Mann in the University of Virginia. Those of us who were trying to get that information said, public policy is being made on this. You have already concluded your studies. And since this was funded by the public because it was done on a public university server, we should be able to see your basic data there. And he said, he claimed privilege, said, this is my private data, even though it was a university email. So he eventually succeeded in that argument. Amazingly, the government allowed him to continue on with that, and he is now at the University of Pennsylvania. But I want to talk about the reaction to your research when we come back from the break. And I also want to ask you about the correlation, because what you're looking at here in terms of analyzing their model and saying that they've calculated the feedback incorrectly, we've also seen an increase in CO2, but we have seen that the oceans are actually cooling, going in the other direction, which predominates over any surface temperature measurements that they make. It's very easy for them to move where they take the surface measurements to make sure that they get the results that they want. It's one of the ways that they hide the decline. So we're going to continue talking to Lord Monckton in the next segment. And I also want to get some information about him as to the state of Brexit, what we see happening in Catalonia, because that is part of the move against the centralization of power into a world government. We're seeing some very interesting developments there. A lot to talk about in the next segment with Lord Monckton. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Lord Christopher Monckton. He has a paper that is going to be presented this week in Dusseldorf, Germany. It's significant that he's doing this at the Karl Popper Memorial Lecture Service, because what he's doing is exposing the fatal error of the climate alarmists. And as we saw from Harrison Ford saying, we've got people who don't believe in science. Lord Monckton, tell us about Karl Popper, the guy who had so much to do to codify the scientific method. It's not based on belief, is it? It's not based on the consensus of a lot of credentialed scientists either.
No, you're quite right. Karl Popper, who was an Austrian scientist, got out just in 1937 because he saw that the Nazis were going to impose their daft consensus science on his country. So he got away to the West, but he had, before he went, already written his masterwork, Logik der Forschung, or The Logic of Scientific Discovery, in which he describes the process of scientific discovery, the scientific method, as it is called, as a rational process of inquiry. You start with a general problem, and the one we've started with is that the models are over-predicting global warming. Then you advance a tentative theory to address that general problem. In our case, the theory is that they screwed up in their models, in their calculation of feedbacks, as we discussed before the break. And then we have an error elimination phase. And this is where the fun really starts. Everybody else then piles in and attacks what we say to try and prove us wrong. And this process.
That's right.
Yeah, and this process began when we submitted our paper to the Journal of Climate. A very short version of the paper, because the point is a very simple point that we're making. And they should have reviewed it and come back with an answer in 2 weeks. They didn't. They took 3 months and then they rejected it. But they didn't reject it on any sound scientific criteria. They rejected it for purely political reasons. And what had happened in the meantime was that somehow, and I will not say exactly how, the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Climate, Dr. Tim Delsole, who handled our paper personally, sent a copy to somebody who sent it to the University of East Anglia, where the vice chancellor got to hear of it, and that's Professor David Richardson. He called a meeting of the entire environmental sciences faculty, some 65 professors and doctors of science, all of whom true believers in the new religion, or as he thought, all of them. In fact, one of them wasn't, which is how I got to hear about it. And that person has managed to keep his or her powder dry by not revealing that he or she doesn't actually believe in the new religion. And the vice chancellor called a meeting. This was in August. It was shortly before our paper was eventually rejected. And what he said was this. This is a catastrophe, he said. If the general public ever gets to hear of Monckton's paper, there will be hell to pay for all of us. And he directed them all to drop everything and to spend as long as it took working completely to recalculate the way feedbacks are handled in climatology, and then to start publishing papers all over the place to neutralize our paper. That was what he did. It was a most extraordinary meeting. There's been never had any of those who were there heard the like of it before. Here was a layman making a very simple point, and instead of saying, this is glorious news, we no longer have a problem with global warming, or we think that, although it would be glorious news, we think that Monckton may have got it wrong, so let us check. Instead, he said, it would be a catastrophe if Monckton was right. Why? Because the money would stop flowing. So what it's all about, for people like the University of East Anglia, it's about the crinkle. It's about the money. That's what they're really wanting.
And it's also about their reputation, because they argue from the position of authority. They don't argue from a position of the science or the math behind this. They argue from the position that, look, we have more people on our side than you do on your side, or we've got more degrees or higher degrees or better universities. It's always this argument from authority rather than a scientific argument. You present a scientific argument to them, and if they walk away with egg on their face, yeah, it's going to have a lot of economic as well as a lot of political fallout for these people.
I think that's true. But one thing it does tell us is they know we're right. Can you imagine this? The editor of one of the leading climate journals sends the paper somehow to the University of East Anglia. I'm not laying any blame here. I don't mind if people circulate our research. It's not the normal scientific ethics. Normally, the reviewers, of whom there were two or three, should have read it privately, commented on it privately, and sent it back to the editor and sent it to us. Somehow, that paper got to the University of East Anglia. But what the vice chancellor's comments show is they know perfectly well that we are right about this. Mm-hmm. And that's why they're worried. And that's a very good sign, because it's going to be very tough to get this paper reviewed in any climate journal, because it's quite clear from the reviews we've had from the Journal of Climate that the reviewers were entirely, and I mean entirely, incompetent to assess the control theory aspects of the paper. And that's what the paper is all about. So we are now approaching control theorists. I've tried to get in touch with the professor of control theory here at the University of Bristol, but he hasn't replied. They're all terrified by this paper. I'm going to try one or two others. And we've also got some of my distinguished co-authors. You'll heard of Dr. Willie Soon at the Harvard-Smithsonian Institute for Astrophysics, Professor yes. David B. Gates, Michael Lindberg himself is an electronic engineer and understands control theory. All of these people are eminent scientists, and they think we're right about this, or they wouldn't be co-authors of the paper. So this is major breaking news. And for the first time in Dusseldorf, I will be spelling out in very nearly an hour-long standard-length academic lecture to the very distinguished audience, mostly from Germany, but also internationally, some from France, some from America, some from Sweden, some from Britain, who will be listening. And these will be high-powered climate scientists, by no means all of them skeptical of the official position. Some of them will be healthily skeptical of my position and that of my team. But we will spell out our argument in full. We will be making all of our data and the underlying academic paper and the full text of my lecture and all the slides. There are 150 slides that are going to appear very rapidly during this 40-minute talk. And all of these will be publicly available, and we will be willing to answer questions from scientists or members of the public.
And, no, and that's the way that it should be. They don't allow that type of questioning of their authority, because that's what they appeal to. And, of course, history is filled with examples of a consensus, a scientific consensus, being shown to be wrong by one person. That's the way science usually advances. There's usually a consensus and somebody who is skeptical. I mean, science is based on skepticism and of proof, not on belief, as Harrison Ford would tell us. We've only got a couple of minutes left, Lord Monckton, and I wanted to get your comments on what's going on with Brexit, because we've seen Nigel Farage say it looks like Theresa May is not really committed to this. He actually called her Theresa Maybe. What is your take on what's happening with Brexit, and if we have time, Catalonia?
I've known Theresa May since she was at Oxford and I at Cambridge, and she is an establishment figure to her fingertips. She hates the idea of Brexit and always has. That's why the government didn't fight the case to delay the letter telling them we were leaving after the referendum, because if they'd fought it properly, they'd have said, look, it is our obligation under the EU treaties to tell our partners we're going, and that would have been the end of the case. They didn't use that line, and from that moment on, I knew that Theresa May, whatever she said about Brexit meaning Brexit, was playing a very dirty game. And of course, how does Catalonia fit into all this? Well, it's a very interesting question, because the post-colonial disposition in international law, something that might commend it to you colonials over in the United States, has it that if a recognizable territory, and Catalonia is about 6% of Spain and 20% of its economy, wishes to form its own administration and votes to do so, then in international law, it has the absolute right to do so, regardless of the constitution of the country it belonged to before. And so although the Spanish government is quite right to say under our constitution you can't do this, under the wider aegis of international law, the Catalans are fully within their rights to seek independence. And their leaders should certainly not be arrested under this ghastly European arrest warrant procedure and extradited back to Spain and flung into jail for it. Though that is how the Spaniards have traditionally dealt with dissenters, they haven't really quite got the idea of democracy yet. Whereas in Scotland, we were much cleverer. What we did was to have a vote, say we would accept the will of the Scottish people, and the Scottish people, realizing what nice people we were, voted by a very substantial margin to remain in the United Kingdom. And that's how it should have been done in Spain. And because they are moving so viciously against the leaders of the Catalan rebellion, you heard it here first, Catalonia will become independent within the next 20 or 30 years, and there's nothing whatever that Spain can do to stop it. Just as we will leave the European Union on the 19th of March 2019, whether anybody likes it or not, we're going. Bye-bye.
That's right. It's an idea that is sweeping the world. And that idea, novelly enough, is what founded America, the right of self-governance. And they're not going to be able to stop that by force. Hope that it does not get violent. Thank you for joining us, Lord Monckton. You can find him and his articles at whatsupwiththat.com. That's it for our program. Stay tuned for Alex Jones.